This interview is with Robert John Wahlfeldt for the Veterans History Project. Mr. Wahlfeldt was in the U.S. Navy from July 19, 1943 to May 10, 1946. He served as an EM-3C and electrical mate third class on the destroyer the USS Waldron in the Pacific. Today is Wednesday, October 17. My name is Harriet Williamson. The videographer and director of lighting and sound is Henry Radcliffe. Also in the studio is Mr. Wahlfeldt's daughter, Jan Cruz. We are in the television studio of WILL on the campus of the University of Illinois in Urbana. Mr. Wahlfeldt, could you please begin by maybe talking a little bit about when and where you were born and a little bit about your family and your education?
I was born in Danville, Illinois on June 7th in 1925. My parents were of Prussian, German-Prussian extract. We went to grade school at a parochial school, the Manuel Lutheran School in Germantown. My folks lived in Germantown most of their life. My dad was a blacksmith and on the Sinai Railroad, where I worked for some time. I went to parochial school system, went to Danville High School, joined the Navy before I graduated from the high school.
Now, because your folks were of a German background, did that affect anything about their lives at the beginning of the war?
Well, the church I went to, they made them quit having services in the German language because of the preacher, Berthal, had been from Germany, and all the scare about people who are from other countries and that, and when you're at war and at odds with them, why they always expect the worst or suspect the worst.
Well, that's pretty significant to end a language in a church. Were there any other effects on your family?
No, we were pretty much community people. My folks, my dad had played baseball, played in the bands, and was a union organizer. My mother worked in a church a lot. She also was an active bowler. In fact, at one time, she even went to Cuba. That was when we were still on friendly terms with them. Otherwise, we were just like every other community people. We did our thing, went to school, and lived in the neighborhood. And I was a Cardinal fan. My mother was a Cub fan.
How did you come to enlist in the Navy?
Well, I was going to high school and also working at that time. I had just gotten a job on the Sinai Railroad as a young laborer in order to help make some money to help with my schooling. And the come vacation time, I went to South Dakota to visit with my, working on the railroad, my dad had a, we had free passes to anywhere in the country two times a year. And I had gone to South Dakota to visit my uncle who had a sheep ranch. And while I was there is when the war broke out. And we talked about it, I stayed there, became acquainted at that time with some Lakota Sioux Indians and fell in love with them. Went back to Illinois, went back to school, and they were talking about draft. And that time they had the draft was in vogue. Were drafting people right and left, and I decided I did not want to parade through mud and rain and water. I decided I would rather ride. So I went down and volunteered for induction into the Navy, and that's how it came about.
Well, let's see, Illinois is a landlocked state, so I was just curious as to how you had chosen the Navy, and you answered that question. When you began your training, where did you go first?
Well, they shipped us to an induction center in Chicago. We were there maybe 3 or 4 hours, and they loaded us on trains and sent us to Portland, Idaho, to the naval base that had just opened there.
Mm-hmm. Now, again, we're in a landlocked area, but you're at a naval base in Idaho, so you're still not on the water yet, is that correct?
That's correct. The after boot camp, they sent me to Norfolk, Virginia, and in, it was called NOB, Virginia, and there they made the assignments. While I was there, my dad was also a horseshoe pitcher, a pretty good one, and so while we were there, we set up horseshoe courts at the training base and waited around there for a while, and then was assigned to a new construction destroyer service, and I was assigned to the Waldron. Mm-hmm. They had a, in this Norfolk, they had one section of the camp set up for Waldron and people that had been assigned to it. The ship hadn't been well enough along to send anybody there. And then on June 1944, they sent us to Kearney, New Jersey, and we went aboard the ship and sort of helped get it ready for the commissioning in that.
Mm-hmm. Can I back up for just a minute and just ask you a little bit about your training in Farragut? At the Farragut Naval Base, that was boot camp for the Navy?
That's right. Mm-hmm. It was made up of about six camps. During that time, we went through not only the training, but also they picked out people for future assignments. They had tests in the pool sections and that to train for. They wanted to know if they had any lifesavers, and all you had to do was dive in and pull somebody along the water, and you were a lifesaver. Mm-hmm. I had been lucky enough when I was still in high school. We used to swim in Lake Vermilion a lot, mm-hmm. and they had a lot of, and there was no fairgrounds in Danville, and they had a lot of swimming schedules and that, and I used to win the backstroke. I got pretty good at that, so I had a lot of experience in swimming backstroke, and that's what helped me then mm-hmm. in boot camp. So they put me on as a lifeguard.
Now, what other kind of training did you have?
I had been a machinist training at the Sinai Railroad when they were the old steam engines. Before that, I worked on the section down in Clinton, Indiana. Worked as a laborer on the section crew, laying track, and mm-hmm. Young high school boys then were pretty much in demand because they were strong and didn't ask a lot of questions. It's the same reason the Army and Navy wanted them.
Mm-hmm. Now, when did you become an electrical mate? Was there any kind of special training for that?
Well, my dad also had a radio shop and did electrical wiring for people in Danville, and I used to go along as a helper. So I had a lot of experience in the nomenclature. Mm-hmm. I knew a lot about it, even though I didn't have the experience of actually laying hands on.
Mm-hmm. Now, did the Navy give you any special training for?
Well, because of the answers you give on your questionnaires, they sent me to Purdue University as a naval training. It was an electrical training institution for the Navy. I went through one of their companies. We did lab work and battery work, things that pertain to Navy-style electrical work.
Mm-hmm. Now, back at Kearney, New Jersey, when you went aboard the USS Waldron, was there kind of a shakeout period then for that ship, and what did that involve?
Well, the ship, we actually got pretty well acquainted with it, and and that's where we got our name. Our ship, although it was the Waldron, got the name as the Bloody W. While we were in dock there finishing up some of the racks for the depth charge racks, one of them fell and actually killed a couple workers there, and our deck was flooded with blood and such a mess, and it sort of scared a lot of the guys that had just come aboard. They didn't know what to think of that, but we managed to get through it, got the ship underway. I went to headed for Bermuda, and on the way to Bermuda, somebody threw a pair of pants in one of the reduction gears, so we had to go back for repairs. We got back, and that was when the Bermuda Triangle was getting its name too, you know.
Oh my goodness.
We, in fact, then on the next trip to Bermuda, one of the ships in our task group got lost in heavy seas. There was a big storm. So all the things that happen to scare a person out and wonder if they made the right decision, if maybe the muddy fields wouldn't have been better, come to mind. Well, but we went back to Chicago and had the last ship's party, and then headed for the Panama Canal through Delaware and the Panama Canal.
Were you able to see your family when you went back to Chicago?
Well, they gave us a few days off when we come back from Bermuda. Another friend aboard the ship went home with me. We were there probably 5 or 6 days and then back to the ship.
Mm-hmm. What was it like to return to civilian life for a few days?
Well, it really was kind of strange. Your room looked bare. It didn't look the same. It didn't have the same excitement that it had when you left. You really were anxious to get back to the ship and get under the regulations and that, to be organized, to know what you were doing.
That's interesting. What was life like on a destroyer? Maybe you could just talk about your first impressions of the ship when you first went aboard.
I had had kind of a bad impression of the Navy while I was in boot camp, and I'm going to bring this up so that my first experiences really were downers. The first night of in boot camp, I put my billfold under my pillow and somebody stole it. Lost all the pictures from South Dakota, which were my favorite.
Oh.
And I really was pretty. But then when we went aboard ship and when went to Norfolk, the training in that we got there was fire training, things like that, that would help us in case we needed aboard the ship. Met some new friends and got excited about two of them, became lifelong friends. And in fact, I'm still very well acquainted with one of them has passed away. The other one lives in Dallas, Texas, and we still correspond. And I have one of the very good friend in San Diego who stayed in the Navy for 30 years, in fact. Board ship, we were assigned compartments. I was in engineering, and so we were close to the electrical shop, so we could move in and out of it. The ship was sort of divided up. Seamen were in one. The people that were in dietetics and that were in another, just depending on where you were and how close to your work, they kept you close to where you had to go.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was assigned aboard ship special duties. One of them was the sound-powered telephones.
Does that mean?
Well, a sound-powered phone is one that has the magnets and that in it, that the sound of your voice vibrates the vibrator, and it carries a sound, so you don't need electricity or any thing like that to send your voice through the wires and that. It was all done by the power of your voice on the magnet, vibration of the magnets. And so that was one of my responsibilities, to look after all of them on the ship. Then another responsibility was I had experience on generator sets, and so I watched the main distribution board was my main watch. I was on four, off four, on four every night. That was during regular sea duty. Mm-hmm. During battle station times, I was assigned to a, at first to a quad 40, which was a four-barrel 40-millimeter gun. They needed somebody with a stronger back up on one of the 5-inch mounts, so they moved me up there, putting projectiles on a ready rack, which was a 54-pound projectile that you took out of a hoist and set up on the rack, which shoved it into the gun mount. We had three twin 5-inch gun mounts, and each one had their own loaders and that. So I was on one side of a 5-inch gun mount.
Now,
I talk with my hands, I know.
The those guns, how rapidly did they fire?
Well, they were all fired through a gun director on the bridge. We fired our particular mount, this number two gun mount, fired so rapidly during one of the kamikaze attacks that it warped the barrel. They had to change the barrel on it.
Is that easily done, to change the barrel?
Well, it's a good chore. They have screw in and are fastened in. Mm-hmm. I'm not too well acquainted. I was an electrician. That was handled by the people who were responsible for the gunner's mates. They took care of things like that.
Now, did you have any health issues as a result of being involved in firing of those guns, like with your back or anything else?
During the war? Mm-hmm. No, I had no problems. I was 17, 18 years old and in very good health. Had worked on a railroad as a gandy dancer, was in very good health.
Mm-hmm. Did you have any problems with seasickness?
Never. I never had never once was seasick, though we had people aboard the ship who carried buckets with them and always had a piece of bread in their pocket. But I had no problems with it.
So going back to your schedule then, not during combat, but on a normal day at sea.
We were all assigned responsibilities to... we had a pretty good electrical gang, had a chief electrician, had several first class, second class, third class, and strikers. At the time I went into the shop, I was electrician, striker, a fireman, first class. Mm-hmm. When I made rank, one of my first responsibilities was making sure all the connections on a electrical board was tight. Mm-hmm. And would have to count your tools and take the covers all off and make sure that everything was tight, and then count your tools before you locked it up again. At that time, I had a apprentice fireman with me. His name was Calvin Reed. And when we were tightening up the board, I asked Calvin, I said, "Well, now, you didn't go get any extra tools, did you?" And he said, "Oh, yeah, I went down and got a suicide screwdriver so I could put a wrench on it." And a suicide screwdriver is one that has a metal side so that you could put a wrench on it and tighten it. Mm. So I said, "Well, where is it?" We have to add a count and a checkoff list. Mm-hmm. And so I had to look around. There it laid between the bus bar on the electric board. He had left it.
Oh, my goodness.
Had we tightened it up and put it online, it would have really knocked it off. So it shows the importance of keeping track of your tools.
Yeah, it sounds like in surgery where you keep track of... Mm-hmm.
So I should have put him on report, but it was his first time, so he became a lifelong friend.
Now, you had said that you went through the Panama Canal. When your ship was going through the canal, were you allowed to have any leave at that point?
Oh, yes. We made several leaves in, I can remember the name of one of the streets, but I can't remember the towns. In fact, we were in one of the the engineers on destroyers had a bad reputation to keep. And while we were in Panama going out to the Pacific, we went to a nightclub, and of course, being a tough sailor, we all fought. We got into a hassle with the people in the bar, and they ended up locking us up in an old building. And there was enough engineers in there, they couldn't, they needed us on the ship. So the captain had to come and get us out, but he told us no liberty for a couple weeks.
Now, were you with a convoy of ships?
Yes, there was a convoy of destroyers. There was probably, we were the 699, and it was the 698 through probably the 700, and I can't remember the names, Hames Works, Ames, a lot of those ships were in this destroyer group that had just been commissioned in New York, or in New Jersey. At the same time, the Missouri, which was the biggest battle wagon, our new battle wagon, was also launched around the same time and commissioned. And it also entered the Pacific at the same time we did.
How long would it take to go through the canal with a big group?
It took
like
us
that?
Probably a couple of days. There's a lock system. You go in and they bring the water up or let it down, whichever way you're going, and you end up in the, at the sea level on the other side.
Did you have maybe a little more confidence because you were on a brand new ship and perhaps it had more up-to-date equipment?
We were all kind of wondering what would go wrong next, because being a new ship, nothing had really. We went on what they called a shakedown ship cruise before Panama and back, which isn't very much of a distance. And then after we went through the canal, we went into San Diego, and from there on to Hawaii.
When you went from the Atlantic to the Pacific, did you see a difference in those two oceans in terms of the way the ship rode? Or
not really. 17-year-old sailor still going to high school, don't even think about things like that. About all I was interested in was doing my job. And
once in Hawaii, then, was that the beginning of being sent into combat?
Yes, we, and there was another big disappointment there, you know, in, well, it wasn't in Hawaii. It was, we got what they, we'd go out and practice shooting at targets flying over with plane targets. And we also had 10 torpedoes on our ship, and we practiced launching them also, and dropping depth charges, the whole gamut of things you do in combat. After they thought we were good enough, especially the firing at the sleeves was our main practice. They didn't give you too much time for recreation and play. They was anxious to get us out in the fleet, because that was right when things was going pretty tough there.
What, now let's talk about the date and get that set. So you're in Hawaii, and is it around 1944, are we talking
yes,
about?
Yes. When I was in Danville, there was a garage where I'd bought my first car. And the son of that man, while we was in Hawaii, here come a guy along on a motorcycle. And it was him.
Oh, my goodness.
Slid off of the road, and he stopped, and we helped him get it up and found out who he was. I've forgotten his name.
Did you see him after the war?
No, never saw him again after that, but I did see his brother, worked with his brother in Danville, but I've forgotten their name. That's quite a few years ago, but that was what they called R&R. I remember seeing people out in the water with the nets catching fish, things like that. We didn't have too much time to get acquainted with very many people there, or they were anxious to get us on the way.
Were you receiving mail from back home at this point in time?
Spottedly, we got mail, yes. At that time, my girlfriend had left Danville and went to Chicago to work for a doctor, to babysit for him, and that was about all.
So you kept up a steady course.
Right, yes, we did. Mm-hmm. That was that, and my parents and sisters were about the only ones I would write to. And then again, you just don't. I didn't do too much writing.
Did you keep a diary?
I kept one on aboard the ship, a one-line diary. Whenever I could think about it, I had a little black book, and I'd write each day what was happening, and later on I copied it off.
Interesting. You're in Hawaii, and it's 1944. What month are we talking about now? Is this around?
Gosh, I don't. Well, we left. It was in October of 44. We went through the canal. And we went to San Pedro, and we arrived in Pearl Harbor on October the 20th. And that's where we had 2 months of anti-aircraft training.
Was that significant for you all to be in Pearl Harbor, given that that was the beginning of the war with Japan?
Well, we didn't get much around where the ships and that had been damaged, and that we were mostly out and at sea training. And then we left Pearl Harbor and went to a little place called Aniwetok Atoll. And we got there. It was on Christmas Day, I remember, in 1944.
And were you able to go ashore there?
Well, no. Well, they gave us five cans of beer and put us on the island and told us that if anybody got sunburnt, they was going to be court-martialed. They wanted to keep us healthy.
Where was your next port of call?
Well, that was a Lithia toll, and we left there and was actually assigned to Task Force 38 from there.
Now, I've read about Task Force 58, but I'm not clear. What is Task Force 38?
Task Force 58 is five units of groups of ships. When two of them go in for R&R, then it becomes 38, and that was the smaller unit of Task Force 58. It was usually commanded Halsey and Spruance were the admirals and that in charge of the task group.
Now, on a day-to-day basis, would you know where you were? And
no, we had no idea where we were. But we did get some pretty nice music from a station that they'd picked up with a lady called Tokyo Rose.
What was it like to listen to her?
She was very good. She had all the latest music, though they would go through the garbage the ships threw out and get the names off of envelopes and things, and that's why we had to be very careful about what we put in the garbage that they threw over the side. And she would announce the names of their so-and-so's mother missed you, she wished you was home, and things like that.
Oh, my goodness.
We would hear things like that.
Was that disturbing when you would hear
No, it was a big joke aboard the ship. We just wanted to hear her music. That was the only way we got to hear the latest music.
What was your first combat experience? Where was that?
Well, combat is more than just planes and things firing on you. We actually went to places like Formosa, South China. We would go and fire. The planes would drop bombs. We would go up and fire from the larger mounts and that. Our ship was called a picket or escort ship. We looked after the carriers. We operated at a distance from the fleet in order to, we had some of the first radar at that time. Radar had just become available for the sea mm-hmm. for the ships at sea, and we were one of the first ships with it. And so we would go out and spot and keep track of what was going on. They had these destroyers stationed around the fleet, outside of the fleet. We were called the dispersibles. And we would be relieved every once in a while. Another ship would come out and relieve us. Sometimes you'd go to relieve a ship, it wouldn't be there, and sometimes the ship never showed up to relieve you. So things like that happened.
When you would be relieved, then what would your ship
do? We would go back into the squadron. We were assigned to a certain area in the group, and that's where we would go.
Did the life on board the ship then change when you were in?
No, it was pretty much the same. When we were out on picket duty and that, we were always on the alert. We had duty on the spotting duty, they called it. We had to always be on the lookout for the planes and that on horizon or ships or whatever. Mm-hmm. And besides, they had the radar going too, and we also had sound gear. We were always looking for submarines. Our ship was kind of a sub chaser too. And one of my responsibilities, they had a big paravane that went down through the bottom that had a sounding device that would, it was called a ping transmitter, would send a signal, and if it hit a another object, it would send back a different signal. And one of my responsibilities was to keep that thing polished up all the time. I used to go down a lot of times and just pull it up and polish and stick it back down through the system. Mm-hmm. It was sort of like an underwater antenna.
Did you encounter, you know, in picket duty, did you also encounter any marine life that was significant, like whales?
Well, we would see, once in a while, we would see porpoise. We'd see a whale, and very seldom. Mm-hmm. We were on the move most of the time. Mm-hmm. We didn't stand still. We were, our top speed was around 35 or 6 knots, and even though it wasn't listed as that fast, but we always claimed we went 36, but we were always on the move. We didn't have chance to see much thing, much marine life. Or
where are some of the other sites that you were in the Pacific?
Well, Formosa, which is Japanese or the Chinese off the mainland of China. And we were in French Indochina, which is now Vietnam. Mm-hmm. We just would travel in. They'd let the planes loose. They would break us up into groups, and we would stay with that particular group of carriers and that while they launched planes that had certain areas to attack. Mm-hmm. And we were there to pick up pilots and that when they come back. If they didn't make a landing or if they had to ditch their planes, we were there to pick them up.
How was that accomplished?
Well, we, on a motor whale boat, on several occasions when a pilot was shot down. In fact, there was one time a pilot we picked up twice, the same pilot, but on different days. And it's amazing. You never hear about a pilot that has gone out that had been shot down. But we would spot them in the water. We'd get a location, you know, the plane cap from the couriers would give us a location, and we'd go to that location. And they would usually either be in a raft or they would have a some dye material that they would throw in the water, and it'd leave a big ring. We'd know where they were. Sometimes with choppy seas and that, it was almost impossible to see it. But we would go out in a motor. We'd get close as we could to them. Mm-hmm. And we'd get in a motor whale boat and go out to as close as we could and dive off the motor whale boat and grab them. They'd pull us back on the boat.
Oh, my goodness. So you'd be in the water with them.
Yeah, sometimes you'd wonder why you ever volunteered.
Yeah.
It was pretty chopping. Sometimes it was hard, pretty hard to swim in it. Mm-hmm. Pretty tiring. They grease you up. We had a plastic harness light or a canvas harness that would strap around you and then had a ring on it, and they'd put a 3/8 line in it. And a motor whaleboat would have an engineer who would run the engine, had a boatswain mate and a couple other people that would able to navigate, know what they were doing. Mm-hmm. And we would sail out to as close as we could, dive in, grab them, and then take them back to the ship. When you get back to the ship, they had plenty of help on the sides to pull them up and mm-hmm. Give them first aid, and then we'd take them to a hospital ship.
Mm-hmm. Was the destroyer pretty self-sufficient in terms of supplies, or did it have to
be
resupplied?
Well, we would usually take on supplies and oil. We refueled at sea many a time. We'd have these big oil lines that we would throw a line over to. Most of the time it would be like a carrier or a battleship or a cruiser. We'd throw a line over to them and mm-hmm. then finally pull an oil line over and fill our fuel tanks with it. Mm-hmm. There were times those lines would break and people would get hurt. And one of my responsibilities there, again, was the sound power phones. Whenever they sent the lines over to the other ship, I also had to send over a sound power phone mm-hmm. so that we could communicate between mm-hmm. the two ships.
Mm-hmm. A lot of responsibilities.
And sometimes in rough water, it was pretty difficult to get those things done, but we always managed to do it.
Were there any times that you were in terrible storms?
Oh, plenty of times. One of the worst one was when we, at one time, they decided that, you probably remember reading about Shangri-La when the bombers, they wondered where they came from and they told them Shangri-La. Well, we pulled a trick. We're off between Japan and we went up into the China Sea. There was a strait up there called the Ballantine Strait. And our ship, a couple other destroyers, and a small, what they called a small aircraft carrier, sailed in under darkness to attack Japan from the backside. Mm-hmm. And this is only a recollection I may have. It's been a lot of years ago, too. But we went into the, and while we were there, one of the worst storms, our ship took a 48-degree roll. Mm-hmm. And that's a pretty good swipe. I don't remember now, but I think it's in the 30s. If they roll 30, you don't straighten up again.
Mm.
So we had to strap ourselves in that at night in our bunks while we were up in there. But we lost ships. In fact, when we were up in the China Sea, they told us to get rid of our ballast because they wanted to be able to hurry out. Well, our skipper was an old-timer who had lost a couple ships in battle up in the Pacific. Mm-hmm. His name was George Peckham, and he wouldn't release his ballast. He kept it, and mm-hmm. we managed through the, he knew how to get through in the troughs and that, mm-hmm. Keep us from having too much damage. But also, when we were at Okinawa, there was a big storm there. They're pretty vicious storms. A hurricane, you can see one happened to Louisiana and mm-hmm. Florida. Well, imagine being out in the middle of the ocean.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I can't, really. Mm-hmm.
So it's, and it's, you just hope for the best.
Mm-hmm. Would you like to talk at all about any further combat experiences?
Well, the, I can tell you that towards the end there, when we were at Okinawa, the sky looked like it was full of black mosquitoes. The kamikaze planes were thicker than anything you've ever seen. I can remember, too, one time watching a projectile from the Missouri. We were firing on the airfield there at Okinawa, and the Missouri was standing off, and it shot a 16-inch projectile, and it just looked like a Volkswagen going through the sky. those were pretty good size.
Did any kamikaze pilots come endangering the Waldron?
No, we didn't. We didn't get hit. Several of our sister ships did. I saw one land in the water beside the ship, and saw the wheels pop up. But and the only reason I got to see it, we had had a hung fire. One of them, when the director of the ship sets the projectiles in the gun mounts, they have a fuse on them that it sets so that they fire at certain distance. And one of them got stuck. We couldn't set it back to zero, and I had to throw it over the side. So I had to open the door and go out on the deck and throw it over. Mm-hmm. And that's when I happened to see the plane in the water. Mm. But outside of that, when you were inside the gun mounts, all you did was loaded the guns. Mm-hmm. You didn't worry too much about what was going on around you.
Mm-hmm. What was your job then after the after combat on the ship? What
well, after the combat, one of my responsibilities was damage repair. I would have to go through all the compartments and make sure that the lighting and everything, after all the firing and that, the lighting and that got shook pretty up to pretty bad. Mm-hmm. They still had incandescents. They didn't have fluorescent lights back then, and it would shake them loose. And so during my duties of cleaning them up, I discovered something that I didn't even know existed in the Navy. One of the upper forward compartments had nine black men in it, and I didn't even know we had black sailors on our ship. Mm-hmm. I got acquainted with them and talked to them and found out they were called steward's mates. Mm-hmm. And their responsibility was to take care of the officers. They would do their clothes, do their cooking, do their washing, whatever they needed done, they were there to do it, waited on. And I thought they were like slaves. I thought, my land, slavery's done. We never seen these young men, and they, when people came, when we were sailing along, and you never saw them aboard above deck with at any time. So I don't suppose half the, or I don't even suppose very many people on the ship knew we had black sailors even. Mm-hmm. So I was got acquainted and made friends and was. Went back there many times just to talk with them. Mm-hmm. And after the war was over, again, I tried to get acquainted. Well, getting back to when we left Okinawa after the landings at Okinawa, and we went back to the signing for the peace accord, we took mm-hmm. all the news bureau chiefs back and they covered the signing. Then we were given duty to check out the islands and the occupation and make sure that reparations took place, that the people on some of the islands got back to the mainland. Mm-hmm. They finally sent us back, and after I got out, we had a they started a ship's historical program called the Half Moon. We had a newsletter called The Half Moon, and we held one of our reunions for the ship in Texas. But these newspaper bureau chiefs had written up for their newspapers about the people aboard the ship. Well, during that conversation, I talked with one of the bureau chiefs about a story for I wanted for my hometown paper, which at that time was the Commercial News. And he said, oh, we can't write that. We can't put that in. We have to go according to what the government allows us to mm-hmm. write. So that told me that there wasn't really freedom of the press. I mm-hmm. got all upset over that. Mm-hmm. And then the article they did about the people in Texas was because the steward's mate was working in the wardroom and the movie operator was from Texas. And they showed special movies for those guys, so they got better acquainted, and they did an article for them in their newspaper, and that's how I got the name of this black man that when we had our reunion there, mm-hmm. and I called him and asked him to come to the reunion, and he said, nope. He said, No one cared about me on a ship while I was there, so why should I care about showing up at your reunion? And mm-hmm. that just made me say, well, I'm going to do something to justify that. And that's what really governed a lot of my life after that. I got very interested in the civil rights movement and worked hard in it. And but that was the reason for it.
When you talked with those sailors, when you first met them, what did they say? What was your conversation about?
Well, they couldn't understand why nobody had any respect for them and why they didn't. And it was an altogether different atmosphere back then, too. Even the black men and women had a different attitude about their lives then. They weren't treated as equals hardly anywhere. Mm-hmm. Back in the 40s, even though Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, the black people never were really free, and they still aren't to this day.
Mm-hmm. So it was really, they were totally ignored because it was only the officers who saw them?
That's correct.
So they had absolutely no contact with
The rest of the ship, that's mm-hmm. correct.
So they were really in isolation.
That is exactly right. Mm-hmm. That's my view of it, yes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll come back to that, but I wanted to ask you about the period after the war, because your ship then was it in Japan?
Yes, our captain had been in quite a few battles there and had lost a couple ships in other destroyers. And I used to know the names, but I've forgotten the names of them. But he was given the responsibility to repatriate people from different little islands around mm-hmm. there. And we would take army officers and...
These were Japanese army
officers? No, these were American officers mm-hmm. that we would take to these little islands, and they would go in and do the work to repatriate and get the people, make sure they loaded up and brought them back mm-hmm. to the mainland of Japan.
Did you bring any Japanese back to Japan?
Not on our ship. Mm-hmm. We would be responsible, though we did see other Japanese ships that we would have confrontations with and have boarding parties go on and take over their ship and then make mm-hmm. sure we'd escort them back to an American base.
Hmm. Well, you had told me that you were among the first people who had entered.
That's right, in Japan, a little place called Yokosuka. Must have been a shipbuilding port because there was this big metal forming shop that I went through, and it was completely, I was the only one in it. It was empty. I just went in and looked curious and walked around through it and even found some little innovations there that I had been working in a machine on a railroad, learning welding, and while I was there, I found some little things that was pretty exciting I'd never seen before.
That's
so I got the idea about some flip-up lids for your welding helmet, you know, little mm-hmm. things you could use without having to reach up and push them up all the time, mm-hmm. different things like that that I picked up and brought back with me.
And that shop was totally empty when you were
yes,
there.
Yes, it was a lot of, it had been bombed, you know, mm-hmm. and things were pretty messed up, papers all over everything. Mm-hmm. And then we had an interpreter, and we went out into the communities and went out in the fields. A little incident, it might seem funny, but we went into this little house, and there was a man and his wife, it was a small place that had these woven mats and mm-hmm. then a little kind of a stepped up table like, and a man and his wife, and he had two young daughters, and they were sitting around the table, and the interpreter introduced us, and we talked for a while. And as you came in the house, there was a little thing, and I thought it was a butter churn. I remember these old butter churns. And I grabbed the handle and was jogging and up and down, and they kept laughing and giggling, and I asked the interpreter, "What's so funny here?" And he said, "Well, just a minute," and he talked to him, and come to find out, it was a basket that had dirt in the bottom of it, and they would put their human waste in that, and that's what they would take out as fertilizer on their field. And so they thought that was funny. I was jogging that thing around.
Was there any fear on the part of yourself in going among the population?
No, they seemed to accept us pretty well. I know that in some of the larger cities, like we went into Tokyo, they had these big compounds with people. And I talked with a Japanese man there that had worked for General Electric in the United States. And he was in the compound, wasn't too heavily guarded. You know, they kept them inside this barrier. They were pretty content to stay there. I had no hostility from any of them. Mm-hmm. We would go up through the towns and these little villages, and the people were anxious. I used to take little pound bags of sugar with me from the ship, because they didn't have any, and you could trade that for almost anything. Mm-hmm. I had a whole array of things I was going to bring back home, and when we got back to the dock, I set them down to talk to somebody, and same problem I had when I first came in. Somebody ran off with them. They had a little, one thing that really intrigued me, they had these little cricket cages, and they would put crickets in them, you know, and I'd say gotten several of those that I was anxious to bring back.
What was your impression of what Japan looked like when you got off the ship?
You know, I was really, first of all, shocked to think that they were so modern and had things so nice. We went into Tokyo, they had street or the pavement, and we went to a barber shop and got our first good haircut, and the sidewalks and that were all with little colored rock and stone. It was so beautiful. Mm-hmm. Ceramics, like well-paved streets, had street cars and that it was so modern. You know, mm-hmm. They had everything that for some reason or other, you didn't expect, or I didn't expect, to find things like that. Mm-hmm. And I was so shocked and so surprised that they were so advanced in their mm-hmm. culture.
What kind of information were you given about the Japanese as a sailor?
Well, really nothing. Mm-hmm. When you go into the military, all they do is teach you how to kill, but they don't tell you how not to when you get out. Mm-hmm. All the time, I can remember when we were going in, they gave us occupation money. Each person aboard the ship got so much. In fact, I still have mine, so many yen that you could spend while you were there. They really, you know, you were mostly on your own. Mm-hmm. You went over in a group and come back.
So were you free then to travel around by yourself?
No. One of the things that happened before they even signed the peace accord, they took people off the ships and put them in on what they called the occupation-type duty, and gave them, I don't know, I think they were M16s or something that you really didn't even know how to use, and we just stood around and held those. But we were waiting for the first cavalry. You know, mm-hmm. the war just ended in Europe, and they were sending the troops and that there, and we had to wait for the first cavalry to come in to do the occupation. Mm-hmm. And so we were sort of on standby for that. They landed them, and finally they brought them in, and then we all went back to our ships.
How long were you on shore then in Japan?
I don't remember the time, not too long. Mm-hmm. We were just there for, you would go ashore for a shift duty, like mm-hmm. maybe 4 or 5 hours, and then you'd go back, mm-hmm. and then you had a certain call time, you'd go back again.
Mm-hmm. Now, once that duty ended, where did your ship go?
Did a lot of inspection of the islands and the ports and that around the mainland of Japan and some of the little islands, mm-hmm. and then they gave us our homeward bound pennant, and we went back to picked up a couple other ships and escorted them back to the United States. Mm-hmm.
Once you were back in the U.S. waters, then were you free to leave, or did your ship continue with other duties?
No, we came back to San Diego, and from there around to L.A., and then back through the canal and went over to Baltimore, Maryland, and made a port call there. And while we were in Baltimore, Maryland, I got to go home for 30 days, and I went home and got married, and that's where Janet's mother.
But did you have to return then to your ship?
Went back to the ship, and they sent me to Chicago in May. I think it was May the 8th or something like that. I got piped off the ship, got on a, they sent me by train to Chicago, discharged and back to Danville. Mm-hmm.
Was being piped off the ship, was that a kind of ceremony?
Well, it was a ceremony. Anytime you leave the ship, they have mm-hmm. a boatswain mate do a piping, what they call a pipe off mm-hmm. and on the ship.
Were the men on your ship recognized in some formal ceremony for their service?
No, it's just like me. I went home on leave, come back, and they said bye.
Now, what was it like to return to civilian life?
Well, I came back home, and I had gotten married while I was home on that leave. Mm-hmm. And I only had 3 days, and we at that time you had to have a lab treatment for you had to do a lot of blood work. And the thing was, I wasn't even old. I was only 20, and I wasn't of age. Mm. My wife was 20, and the women were 18, they were called of age, so mm-hmm. she could sign for herself. I could had to get my mother to sign for me. Mm-hmm. So there was a doctor in town who did the blood work. We took it to the lab and took it back, and then got the license and mm-hmm. Got married. And then I went back to the ship, and she stayed in Danville.
So when you got to return from Chicago, then what happened in your life? What did you do?
Well, first of all, I think they called it something in 10. You had so much, they would give you a monthly check for so many months, and mm-hmm. I came back and looked around for a job, and discovered that the old railroad, Sinai Railroad, where I had worked, was responsible to give me a job back. Mm-hmm. So I went back and went to work as a laborer on the railroad, and then got a job as a helper, and then a helper apprenticeship, and I learned a machinist trade.
Mm-hmm. Now, you had been interested, as a result of your experiences on the ship, in becoming involved in the civil rights movement. When did that come to the fore? When did you become involved in community activities?
Well, I worked on a railroad till 1960, and then I transferred, and it's a long story about how I transferred from the railroad to the government service, because I saved a guy's job that worked for the government, and he was the machine shop foreman mm-hmm. at the on the VA, and he said, if you ever want a job over here, come on over. So mm-hmm. I had decided I didn't want to work for the railroad anymore, and he gave me the job, and I went over, and while I was there, I was assigned to I was a machinist, worked out of the machine shop, but I was very interested in talking and working with the people on the in the facility, and there weren't any blacks hardly. There, in fact, you didn't see any blacks in the VA facility. And I got on a committee called the EEO Equal Employment Committee, and so we, I met a social worker there who was also on the EEO committee, and a young black nursing assistant. His name was Charles Quarles, and we talked about, well, they need to hire more black people here, more black people on at the. At that time, they didn't even have the black historical. We got the first display there. Bird Zell was the director who gave us $1,000 to spend to put displays about the people who had black historians.
Now, where was this that the displays were located? Where were the displays?
Well, we bought some display cases and put them in the lobby of the main building, the VA.
Oh, in the VA.
Yes, and we talked with the personnel department. Tried to get them to hire more black people. They finally started bringing them in, and then they wouldn't hire them for a while because they said, "Well, they come and get a job, and they get their first paycheck, and they leave." They don't come to work for a few days, so we even started a committee to, whenever they hired a black person, we would take them aside and teach them how to keep their jobs. And then it became the thing all over the country. They were going to hire more black people, so Charles Quarles and I used to go around to the colleges and high schools and talk to the young people about making application for jobs at the VA. Then,
okay, you were just talking about you and Charles Quarles went to various high schools and colleges
to encourage young blacks to make application for jobs on the, at the VA. Our committee even wrote up a handbook that was used pretty well nationwide. One of the people, other people on the committee was Gene Vanderport, who was at that time a social worker at the VA. He left there and later became the district leader for the EEA here in Champaign-Urbana. He's the negotiator for all their school contracts here. But I can remember one time they hired a personnel director for personnel. His name was Rollin something, and I can't remember his last name. But after an EEO committee meeting, it was an EEO committee meeting, I asked him, "Rollin, why don't you hire more black people here?" And he said, "Well, let me tell you, Wahlfeldt, with you, it's dedication. With me, it's a job." He said, "I have to follow the whatever lines they give us." And so that was one of the reasons. They were pretty well restricted. In fact, we made such a fuss over it at one time, the VA would not allow anyone on our committee to even talk to each other. We couldn't meet anywhere. We couldn't use any of the copy machines. And we would meet at people's at each other's houses off station. They wouldn't allow us to quit the committee. They told us if we did, it was considered a collateral duty. We'd be fired. And so while I was on that committee, one of the men who was a physical therapist at the station, his name was Fred Baker. He had graduated from Tuskegee, and I had worked with him in the football sessions in Danville, the youth football league. I'd met Fred, and we'd worked together there. So he was on the Danville Human Relations Commission at that time, and it had probably been in vogue about 12 years at that time. And he put my name up, and Roland Craig, who was mayor, then asked me to become a member of it because of my work at the VA, which I did. And then when he lost his job the next year, Palmer became mayor. And we hired our first EEO director, And we did a search, and we met this man from Chicago. His name was Philip Smith. At one time, he had been the had run the Coleman Young's bid for mayor of Detroit and got him elected. So he also worked very well in Chicago. His family was involved in the politics of the city. He had run for one of the jobs as an alderman in Chicago, but he became our first EEO chairman or director in Danville. And while he was there, he was too political. At that time, it was a commission system yet, the mayor and four commissioners. And when we hired him, our committee wrote the ordinance for him to be the director, and we gave ourselves the hiring and firing rights so the city couldn't hire and fire him without mm-hmm. us. Mm-hmm. So they did away with our commission to fire him. And in fact, we got so upset we formed the commission in exile and had it on file with the state and kept right on working and put out a newspaper. And the city at that time tried to keep us from publishing the newspaper. Well, we published it in Chicago. We printed it at Phil's house. And then we really got bad with him. After firing Phil, of course, he got a lawyer and later on won a suit against the city, the only one that the city ever had to pay for a year's service without having the service there. Mm-hmm. But he then went on to Stone Mountain, Georgia. We kept things going in Danville. When I moved to Champaign, I got acquainted with a Ware over here, and I liked it so well, I sold everything and moved to Urbana and Champaign. And I gave the commission to a young lady, or a lady by the name of Gloria Thompson Brown. And she kept it up for a few years working with migrants and that. And there's another Habitat for Humanity here in Champaign or Urbana. Tanya Parker, who runs that, was a protege of Gloria. So all the things goodness. Work, you know.
It's fascinating. Can I read a quote from your daughter, Jan? She says right. that... you never got to go to college, but when Jan brought home her college textbooks, you would always study them and often would get more out of them than she did. So what was it you were studying in those textbooks?
Well, I always wanted to be a teacher, mm-hmm. and books has always been important in our life. Even though I didn't get to go to high or college, I always did a lot of reading. And she would bring the books home. They were some that I hadn't seen or heard or knew about. Some of them were in psychology, and she went to a school in called River Forest. It was a teacher's training mm-hmm. College for the Missouri Synod Lutheran Church. And she would bring the books home and for each semester, and man, those things were something I really latched on to, and I would read them. I'd stay up nights and get everything I could out. I wanted to get my money's worth.
Well, looking back on your experiences in World War II, did they form your life in any way besides your work as a community activist?
Well, it was the civil rights movement that they really got me excited about. I was so hurt about the way those young black men were treated. Mm-hmm. And I was bound and determined that I couldn't believe that all people in the United States didn't have the same freedoms. And then back then, too, you'd go talk to some, even people in your own church, you know, you'd talk about the black community. They didn't even want to give them that they had hearts and minds and cares and worries and feelings just like you had. They were looked at as a different type of a person. And it just, our family was brought up. We always had an empty bed in our house or a place for a meal. If a child or someone got thrown out of their house or family, our house, when we grew up, there was always a place for them. Mm-hmm. So we always got used to having people around that you cared about, and you mm-hmm. always cared about somebody.
Thank you very, very much.
I hated to go so rambly, but
you didn't ramble
it's
at
hard
all.
For me to remember a lot of that stuff.